I'm Drew Stevenson. This is a video for my professional responsibility class or for those who are preparing for the MPRE. Here I'm going to give a quick introduction to the ABA Model Rules of Professional Conduct, which is most of the content that we will cover in my course. This is just a brief overview with some study tips for students. I'm not going to cover individual provisions of the model rules here. So what are the model rules? Well, the American Bar Association, or ABA, publishes the Model Rules of Professional Conduct for lawyers. They have a special committee that drafts them and makes amendments and so forth. They also publish the Code of Judicial Conduct for judges. For my students, remember that these are model rules, sort of like the Model Penal Code or a Uniform Act or the Uniform Commercial Code, that you may have encountered in other law school courses. What that means is that each state bar or state Supreme Court adopts its own set of rules governing lawyers, but these are usually based on the ABA model rules. In fact, most states will have adopted some of the model rules verbatim, and others they'll have made minor changes to. But it's the rules of each state that are binding on the lawyers there. In other words, what are enforceable, not the model rules themselves. So why do we study these rules? Well, as I said, the MPRE tests the model rules, not your state rules. And state ethics committees and state bar grievance committees and courts treat the model rules and comments as very weighty, persuasive authority. So it's good to know these, because even if your state has slightly different provisions or hasn't adopted one of the recent amendments to the model rules, whatever the model rules say carries a lot of weight. Keep in mind, though, that the ABA itself does not license attorneys or bring disciplinary actions for violations of ethical rules. The state bars do that. In other words, complaints against lawyers go to the state bar, not to the American Bar Association. What about those comments? These are really important, actually. The MPRE tests the ABA comments as if they are provisions of the rules. So you should pay special attention to the specific exceptions or applications that of the rules that you find buried in the comments. And also pay special attention to examples in the comments, because these are easy to turn into multiple choice questions. I do want you to notice as we go through the course that vague words like reasonably and materially and substantially occur often in the model rules. Almost every rule has one or more of those words. You met the word reasonable or reasonably in your torts class in your first year of law school, and hopefully you remember how there was no clear definition of that rule. You probably encountered a phrase like substantial performance in your contracts class and had a confusing array of cases in your casebook where they interpreted substantial differently, and that's true with the model rules as well. That being said, multiple choice questions on the MPRE are most often about specific provisions, like exceptions to the rules, and not about the vague general provisions, like the lawyer has to do something reasonable in a certain situation. I hope you can see why someone has to sit down and write the multiple choice question that's going to be either on my final exam or on your MPRE. And that's a lot easier to do with a specific provision of the rule than something that's very open-ended. In legal practice, though, vague terms give a disciplinary tribunal wider discretion to decide whether a lawyer deserves punishment. In other words, they can make case-by-case decisions considering the totality of the circumstances. They can consider all the evidence and factors to decide if the lawyer acted reasonably, for example, under the circumstances. Okay, when you start going through the model rules, you're going to find that they're numbered, and the numbers correlate to groupings that are topical. So all the rules that start with one, like 1.3, 1.7, 1.18 relate to the client-lawyer relationship. So this will cover things like confidentiality, conflicts of interest, and fee arrangements. In contrast, the rules that start with 3 are specifically about litigation and practice before a court, and so forth. So the numbering of the rules kind of indicates the topic. Within each grouping, there will be several rules. Within each rule, you'll notice that there's a repeating structure in how they're drafted. So the first section, A, or the A section of each rule, is a broad prohibition or requirement. So it says a lawyer has to always do this or shall never do this. And then typically in the A section, there's an A1 and an A2 after the introductory kind of sweeping generalization that are qualifiers that sort of limit the scope of the rule. And then section B in almost all the rules will list the kind of categorical exceptions to the rule. If there are other sections like C, D, a few of the rules even go up to G or J, those are usually specific case rules. So things that aren't exactly an exception, but are something under that heading of that rule that relates to a certain type of lawyer or a certain type of special client. The first section, like in many codes, is a definition section, 1.0. I don't teach this in my course, but we will refer back to it a few times. Most of these are pretty obvious, but a few, like the definition of knowingly, are terms of art and are important for interpreting some of the other rules. And that concludes our quick introduction to the ABA Model Rules of Professional Conduct.